funeral service. This is a celebration of life. You can see the photos all around the place to celebrate some of the great things my brother did, some of the great things that he stood for. And we come to praise my brother, not to bury him. And with that, we have a number of very important people here, the most important being my sister. And she is here from Lakewood, Ohio, a place that she and her husband rarely leave, but because our brother has passed away, she is here, and she's going to open this with a few remarks. My sister, Teresa Joss.
My voice is old. If you can't hear me, just, I'll try again. Al and I both enjoyed a lot of times together, and it was very hard to think of, well, what reminiscences should I include in these brief remarks? But we traveled from Ohio to honor Alan and to thank my brother Robert and his precious family for the care that they gave Al during his final illness. They offered him love and such comfort and kindness through it all, and I am eternally grateful. I was going to choose a memory that reminded me of all my great times with Alan, like we were in a play together at Kane Park Theater in Cleveland Heights when we were both teenagers. It was Brigadoon, and you might have heard the wonderful harpist playing some music from Brigadoon tonight. Then I thought, well, no, maybe I'll share the memory that I love about Alan. Was a great, how shall I say this? He was a person that saw beyond what was on the surface. He loved to really listen to people and get to know people. And he was a great caregiver for my aunt and uncle. And as my aunt was failing, she would often say to him, Al, take me home, take me home. So Al and I worked out this plan over the phone, which is how we talked in those days, no texting then. And we decided that it would be a good idea. Well, Alan carried it out beautifully. He would put Aunt Terry in the car. He would drive her all around Van Nuys, drive her back into the driveway and say, oh, Auntie, now we're home. And that kept her going for a long time. I also wanted to share for a minute Al's great gift to our mother. Our mother was a lover of poetry and wrote some poetry herself. And Al knew that. So he surprised her for her birthday with a book of her poems and a biography and family history and so on. That was such a gift to my mother that I think everyone on our side of Cleveland has my mother's poem book that Al did for her. It's been just wonderful. I hear Al's voice. I loved Al's voice from the time I was a little girl. And he was a great debater, and even in high school and college. And as always, I tried to follow in his footsteps and never quite kept up, but always had that wonderful example to shoot for. But our phone calls got to be so special to me in the last several years. And I would call and I'd say, hi, big brother, this is your little sister calling. And he'd say, hi, little sister. And that was just kind of our thing. Well, we'd talk about movies and all kinds of things. And one of the latest movies I can remember a great conversation about was The King's Speech. We both loved that. He always respected the work I did in speech pathology, and he wanted to know all the details about whether the movie was accurate. Did they use the right techniques? I said, in 1942 in Great Britain, they absolutely used the right techniques in that movie. And King George VI of Britain, he really struggled with his stuttering problem, but he wanted to lead the people of England during this time at the beginning of World War II. So Alan really admired his perseverance and how hard he worked to get the stuttering under control so he could give speeches to the people. And I wanted to quote something from a New Year's message from King George VI of Britain, right at the beginning of World War II. I said to a man at the gate of the year, give me a light that I may go forth into the unknown. And the man replied, put your hand into the hand of God. That shall be to you better than a light, safer than a known way. Al has put his hand into God's hand. Now I hear Al's voice in prayer. And I close with this quote from St. Paul. As for me, I am already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. My prayer for Al is eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him, and may he rest in peace. Amen.
You know, you never expect to lose a brother. You expect to lose your parents, but not a brother. It probably should occur to you that if your brother is 13 years older than you are, you will someday lose him, but you don't think like that. And when it happens, it's difficult. You know, in today's event, and again, thanks so many of you for being here. Thank all the track people, all the results people, all the softball people, all the other people, whoever you are, all the law people. Thank you all for being here. It's so special to our family. Today's event follows so quickly and almost so cruelly on Al's 80th birthday party. So many of you were there 2 years ago. Less than 2 years ago, we were at Denny's. I also want to say that my brother was a man of great social conscience. He would never dream of having an event at a place like this. And if you knew my brother would be fighting down in the streets below, protesting against the well-to-do up here. A lot of you know Al as an athlete. He was indeed an athlete. But there was so much more to Al, and I want to tell some of you about it. He was born in Cleveland in 1932. He was the first of four children. One of the family's early memories is how he became a Cleveland Indians fan. You become an Indians fan by default if you are from Cleveland. My sister, my beautiful, beautiful sister and my brother, when they were kids, used to go to the old Cleveland Stadium, and he would keep score of all the Indians games, and they'd look for programs afterwards so that they weren't able to go there. He could still keep score. And those of you that play softball will know that Al to this day, or you know, until last week, whenever it was, kept score, and he kept stats, and he kept data, and he kept everything going, and the results he achieved were remarkable. But the name the Indians for our softball team came from back in the 30s in Cleveland, and the attention to detail started back then. The next great event for my brother was that he went to a Catholic high school in Cleveland. A funny thing happened to him there. They told him to take care of his fellow man. They told him, you know, blessed are the poor, for they shall inherit the earth, or whatever they say. And Al actually listened. I obviously didn't. But he began at that point to live his life for the good of others. He lived his life, he devoted himself to his family, to his friends, and to his fellow man. He moved to California, and when he moved to California, he became a disc jockey. He had, as my sister pointed out, a golden voice, and she liked to hear the sound of his voice, and it was a natural for him to go on the air. And he worked in small markets like Ridgecrest, and then he had a show here in the San Fernando Valley on KBLA, and they were grand times. They were grand times for me personally, because when I was 15, I was able to visit him, and he introduced me to one of the Everly brothers. To this day, I can't remember whether it was Don or Phil. And he also introduced me to Judy Vroom, who was my first girlfriend. And I was 15, and they were wonderful times, and I couldn't wait to get back out here and join my big brother again, which I was able to do a few years later, and permanently. Al's major attention was in track and field and in publishing related to track and field. He created a publication called the National Masters News, which is now a thriving publication. One of the folks who is here today, Ken Stone, has talked about how in the track and field world, Al was our chronicler and our conscience. And to understand how Al was the conscience for the track and field world, they wanted to go to South Africa one year, a long time ago, and Al said, we can't go to South Africa because of apartheid. And they didn't, because of Al. When apartheid was lifted, the first person saying, let's go to South Africa, was Al, and the whole organization went to South Africa for their program. I want to say Al was a loyal brother. I mean, that goes without saying to those who know both of us. Without getting deeply personal, I will say that when I had the darkest times of my life, the only person at my side was my brother. Al was the best man at my wedding. Al was the best man in my life. On the football field, as our friend Glenn Unger has said, Al was the calming influence in the huddle. When everybody else would be going psycho, Al would say, hey, we're here for fun. And the next thing you know, we'd complete a pass and we'd go on. In softball, as our friend David Newman said, Al was a gentle giant. Al was, in softball, Al was one of the Sheahen brothers. It was a name that was at first derogatory. It was coined by our detractors. But as time went on, the Sheahen brothers became a term of respect. And it attested to this, and I'm not trying to be immodest here, I'm not trying to be a jerk, but we won 7 championships. Okay? And that's Al. Al was at the helm. That's why we won. We had fun. We made great friendships. Look around the room. And I will take to my grave the pride and the joy in being half of the Sheahen brothers from softball. Al had courage. There's courage in sport. There's courage on the battlefield. But Al had a different kind of courage. Al had moral courage. Al had the ability at all times to stand up for what was right. He stood for ideas. He stood for ideals. He was tall, and he stood tall against injustice and against inhumanity. As tall as he was always willing to bend over to help those in need. If you want to understand what Al was like, there's a character in his favorite play, his favorite work of literature, that he was like, and that's the bishop in Les Miserables. If you remember the bishop, he's the one, when Jean Valjean is caught stealing, the bishop says, you forgot the expensive candlesticks. And he will not, and he sets John Valjean off on course to have a good life. By the same token, if you knew Al, he couldn't bear the thought of a child going to bed hungry at night anywhere. It pained him to see an anguished mother unable to feed her children. If you look at some of his writings, which we've enclosed, he wrote for Mother's Day 10 years ago, "What job could be more important than that of being a mother?" And he urged welfare reform, economic reform, to allow mothers to raise their own children with dignity. And that was what Al was all about. If there is a heaven, Al is in it. He wasn't religious, but he was the most Christian I have ever known. My brother would drive an old car, yet he would always have a check for a charity or for one of my children who needed some help with tuition. It says in the Bible to take care of the poor, and in Matthew 25 it says, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or in prison and come to you?" And in Matthew it says, "Assuredly, I say to you, as much as you did it to one of these, the least of my brethren, you did it to me." And Al spent his life taking care of the least of his brethren. And I rest assured that if there is a heaven, Al is in it today. When Robert Kennedy was killed, his brother Edward Kennedy spoke at his funeral. And I want to just quote it for a second because these words could not apply more than to my brother today. Senator Ted Kennedy said of Robert, "My brother need not be idealized or enlarged in life beyond what he was, enlarged in death beyond what he was in life. To be remembered simply as a good and decent man who saw wrong and tried to right it, saw suffering and tried to heal it, saw war and tried to stop it." They say in Hamlet, "He was a man. Take him for all in all. I shall not look upon his like again." If you want to remember Al, we've got some people here from one of his charity groups from Results. Go to results.org and make a contribution. If you want to be a little more personal, next time you see a homeless guy on the street, give him a dollar and say, "That's for Al Sheahen." Don't judge the person. Don't ask him what he's going to spend the dollar on. Don't wonder if he's going to buy drugs or alcohol. Just give him a dollar and say, "That's for Al Sheahen." And when the guy says, "God bless you," which most good homeless people do, just remember, that'll be my brother saying, "God bless you." The world is emptier today without Al, but the world was so, so lucky to have Al for 81 years. Thank you again for coming. The next person you're going to hear from is my son, Kyle.
Hey everyone, I'm Kyle. I'm Uncle Al's nephew. Dad is always a tough act to follow, so thankfully I'll be following it just with Uncle Al's own words. I'm going to be reading a couple of his articles that he wrote. He was widely published. We've gathered a number of those in the books on your guys' tables, and there's a couple articles around the room as well. Before I start, though, I just want to give a really quick story of my uncle. I was fortunate enough to do a legal clerkship with the Senate a couple years ago when I was still in law school. And anyone who knows Uncle Al knows that he was very political. He was very involved in public things in the public interest, and you know, he always followed what was happening in Congress and in Washington and, you know, Sacramento here very closely. And so when I was at the Senate, you know, there's some little bookstore there where you can get Senate pins and microphones and whatever. And there's this book that is basically just the Senate procedural rules, right? I mean, these are the rules about referring legislation to committees and scheduling and raising measures on the floor and filibusters and things like that. And it's just a very nuanced, arcane kind of little publication. And I was like, this is perfect for Uncle Al. This is great. So I bring it back to my office in the Senate, and my boss comes up to me, picks up the book, looks at it, and says, "What is this?" The most quizzical, skeptical expression you can imagine. And I kind of look up at him. I'm like, wait, is this bad? Like, what's going on? And I'm like, it's for my uncle. I think he's really going to like it. And the quizzical expression slowly turned to a very serious look from my boss. And he said, "Your uncle must really care about this country." And he does. Anyways, this is from the LA Times. This is from January 11th, 2005, about redistricting, which, you know, I think a lot of people might find it a very boring political subject, but Uncle Al understood that it's actually very, very important to keep an eye on redistricting rules. He said, "The first rule of redistricting should be all voters in a city or community should be in the same district. Under the current boundaries, if you live in Van Nuys, you could be in the 40th or 42nd Assembly District. In the Sunland, Tahunga area, one side of Foothill Boulevard is in Brad Sherman's 27th Congressional District, and the other side is in Howard Berman's 28th. It is bad government, bad policy, and bad democracy. Under the governor's plan, three retired judges, not the legislature, would draw the boundaries every 10 years. It may not be perfect, but I urge our legislators to support it." And then I'm going to read one more. This is from a little bit further back, July 21st, 1967. This is from Time Magazine. "Dear sir, there's a kind of hippie you did not mention, the working hippie, who works in a 9-to-5 job as a clean-shaven, productive member of society. In his gut, he practices the same philosophy of the more publicized hippies, but he is so unconventional and nonconformist that he doesn't need to wear bangles, beads, and a beard to prove that. In spirit, he is a hippie. In time, dropout hippies may realize that they can do as much or more on the inside of society as on the outside. Until then, we should be everlastingly thankful to them for reminding us of the values we are all supposed to possess." I love that letter. Anyways, I'm just going to finish with a quote from one of the greatest statesmen in United States history, Senator Daniel Webster, who said, "What a man does for others, not what they do for him, gives him immortality." Thanks, Uncle Al.
The next people you're going to hear from are my daughter Kelly and my niece Laura. They do not have the passion for speaking, fortunately, that the rest of us have, and Kelly and Laura will sing their remembrances of Uncle Al.
My homeland forever. Songs in store. My cousin's going to join me again in a minute, but first I wanted, we couldn't do this. Uncle Al loved show tunes. You know, he loved The Sound of Music, he loved Les Miserables, he loved Brigadoon, so of course we had to honor him with show tunes, but my uncle was also a DJ in the 50s, the original K-Rock up in Ridgecrest, so I'm going to sing a Buddy Holly song as well.
Spoil the view, but it's raining, raining in my heart. The weatherman says clear today. He doesn't know you've gone away, and it's raining, raining in my heart. Oh, misery. They mustn't show, but soon these tears are bound to flow, 'cause it's raining, raining in my heart, raining in my heart. Dead, I well may be. until you come to me.
I really love it when we can have a traditional Irish wake. And to hear the girls sing Danny Boy is truly a blessing. Al and I have a third Sheahen brother whom almost none of you know, but he came here from Maryland for this event. And he's going to discuss with you some of Al's achievements in track and field, and that's our brother Tom.
I just want to share one little short thing that I think absolutely is characteristic of Al, that is so special, and we may never see again in anyone else. I remember being at, I think it was, Hofstra College in, I don't know, the middle of 1990 or 89 or 91, somewhere around in there, at the Masters National Championship in Hempstead, Long Island. And I had a couple of events that I was participating in, but mainly I was in the stands watching most of the time. Well, the public address announcer was Al Sheahen. And right at his side was Pete Mundell, who is still here today with us. It seems that there was this race going on out there on the track, which was basically the 80 and above men's competition in some distance like the 440 of the mile or something like that. Well, guys over 80 don't run real fast, do they? So here is, from the point of view of a blank, uninterested spectator, a bunch of old guys shuffling along the track. However, Al's announcing of this race, to me, in that moment, or those moments, it captured the magnificent understanding he had of the sport he loved so well, running and track. He knew who was on American record pace, who was on world record pace, who was catching up, who was in what category, and so forth and so on. And to be in the stands and watch people seemingly kind of shuffling around the track would be considered pretty slow. But not when Al was announcing. And it was a really exciting race, and you really cared because of the way he called the race. And that's, I think, just epitomizes the specialness that Al had in the way he understood the sport, the way he understood the competitors, the way he understood people. And it was really magnificent. I could go on at great length and tell you about other events and other things and so forth, other good memories I have from our childhood. If Brother Robert will give me time, I'll talk about how the origin of football took place in my family. But mainly the point about the announcing. Indeed, he was a great announcer, but the reason he was great was because he understood, he cared, and he really made it interesting for everybody. And that's something very, very special. And I hope you will all appreciate that for a very long time.
Tell us more.
My son Scotty went to a school up in Connecticut, a prep school. And his Uncle Al helped set him up there. And he helped pay for it. And his Uncle Al was just wonderful to Scotty. I don't want to embarrass anybody, nor do I intend to say anything political in any way, shape, or form. But when we went up for Scotty's graduation, one of Scotty's friends said he was embarrassed. And this is a senior in high school, at a prep school in Connecticut. And Scotty asked his friend, why is he embarrassed? You know, everybody's family was coming. And the friend said, well, I've got two dads. And it was kind of funny. It's kind of at the at the dawn of same-gender couples. I mention it in the context of Scotty had two dads, too. My brother, from the time Scotty was a small child, my brother was a dad to Scotty. He took great pride in everything Scotty ever did. He followed Scotty everywhere. You know, when Scotty played hockey, Al was there. You know, whatever Scotty did, Al was at his side. And so, as much as I was a father to Scotty, so was my brother. So Scotty had two dads, and here's Scotty.
Thank you very much for everyone for coming. I appreciate it, and so do we all. For anyone who doesn't know me, as my dad said, I am Scott Sheahen. I'm Uncle Al's nephew. First, I'm going to start off with our other brother, half-brother, Jim, who couldn't make it, but he did send some remarks along, and actually, it's kind of appropriate. If you know my uncle, he was, you know, I don't want to say a crazy politician, person, political, but he definitely had a thought and opinion. And actually, he was 87, so it was yesterday, 87, that he kind of changed my half-brother's life a bit before I talk about what I wanted to. So I'm going to read a little bit of what he said. So this is my half-brother talking, Jim. 26 years ago, I had a 30-second conversation with Uncle Al that changed my life. The day August 9th, 1987, which is, like I said, pretty interesting, that's today. Excuse me. Oh, here we go. Since many of my family were Republicans, I assumed he was, and I asked him, "Are you a Republican?" And he responded, "No, not at all." And then my uncle went on to say, that he encouraged me to look at the issues and study the issues that are most important to me at death. He also instructed me to ignore the 15-second sound bites that you see on TV because they're uninformative, subjective, and biased. Finally, he said to me, "Once you've studied the issues and decided what is most important to you, go and vote your conscience." That 30-second conversation that Jim had with my uncle changed his life and has changed the way he has been in the political realm. So now I'm going to go to what I had written. As most of you probably are aware, my uncle is a very compassionate person. He went out of his way to make sure, or he went out of his way for the betterment of everyone. For example, if you would like do something that wasn't that important, like a book a reservation or something, he would purposefully misspell his name to the more common way of spelling Sheahen, S-H-E-E-H-A-N, to make it easier for other people. And whenever anyone would ask him, or at least whenever I would ask him, ask him how he was doing, he would always go through it briefly and then quickly come back to me or whoever else, because he was always more interested in how you were doing and if you were doing okay than talking about himself. One of the things I'll always remember about my uncle is our talks we would have on my way to hockey games and baseball games. They were always long because we were always stuck in traffic. But that's usually what they were about. How to fix LA traffic problems, the subways, how to build subways, make high-speed rails. He really kind of instilled the looking out for the betterment of other people in me. And I'll always remember that. Uncle Al was very humble. Despite growing up in a negative childhood of the Depression, he lived a very positive life. And I'd like to read a few of his accomplishments that he wrote himself in 2005. I'm not sure if he wanted me to read his journal, but that's how I defined his accomplishments. He never really talked about them that much. Number three, his big book, his publishing of his big, which you guys see around. We have a bunch of hard copies if you guys want any. Number four, staying fit and weighing 183 pounds. He always kept a log of how much he, his daily intake of calories. Number seven was his track and field announcing. Number nine was the National Masters News, so pretty quickly right there, thank you. Number 14, me. number 17, him hosting a radio show. That's probably why I started hosting radio shows. 23, he raised $100,000 for the kids in 1994. In his number 40, his 42 is at age 45, he ran 800 hurdles in 62.2 seconds.
400.
If that wasn't good enough, he did the 200 in 2 minutes, 10 seconds, point two. And that was at 45. So if anyone wants to do that outside, I know I can. Number 56, my dad kind of mentioned it, but he didn't fully go through it. My uncle helped 4 people here through some form of college or another. My dad, brother, sister, and me. Number 58, him going to all of his trips for the National Masters News, Switzerland, Japan, South Africa, Germany, Rome, London. And number 69, I kind of added a little bit to it because this was in 2005, his senior softball, and as you guys saw, well, now 7 championships in 13 years. Those are just a few of his accomplishments. It's important for us all today to take the time to reflect on all the accomplishments we were a part of with him. It doesn't matter if you knew Uncle Al for a lifetime or a day, you all made as much of an impact to him as he did to you, and I thank you for being in his life.
I don't know who wishes to speak. You are all welcome to speak. I believe Ken Stone wishes to speak.
Yeah.
Hello, everybody. Track and field people may know me. The softball people may not. I have a website called masterstrack.com, which if you type in masters and track into Google, it's been the number one site for the past 12 years. I consider myself Al Sheahen 2.0, but really more like Al Sheehan's mini-me. He inspired me because he was the man in Masters Track Media for many years. And when I came and started my little website in 1996, I was doing, in a sense, what he was doing in print, I was doing online, but at a very less ambitious landscape. Linda and David Payne, David Payne is, of course, the founder of Masters Track in the United States, and with his first wife, Helen, spread the gospel of Masters Track across Europe and Oceania. He wasn't able to come today. David is, I think, 91 now, and Linda, his second wife, sent me a note today saying she wasn't able to drive him up today, so she provided some information that I'd like to read. These are just a few things that come to mind about Al. If you could let Al's family know how much we enjoyed and appreciated our friendship with Al, we would be grateful. We have many wonderful memories that were always so pleased when we made this, when he made the special effort to come to San Diego. We all had great fun talking politics, enjoyed a sense of humor in our conversations, discussions, debates about the Masters' past, present, and hopes for the future. A while ago, Al came to San Diego for our local senior Olympic track and field event at the Olympic Training Center to put on the National Masters News age-graded championship race with Steve Scott and some of our outstanding local senior Olympics runners. It was well-received, and everyone had a good time with his unique idea of age-graded starts. And that means that there are 2 ways of age-grading a race. You can either you basically have, in a 100-meter dash, you would have the oldest people run the shortest space, and the youngest run longer with the intention, if they're properly age-graded, that they all finish in a tie for first. Because age-grading allows you to
grade people at older ages and compare them to their younger selves. So he also did an age-graded race where every 10 seconds somebody would start and the idea is everybody finished at the same time. He served as an outstanding announcer for several of our events locally, nationally, and internationally, sometimes under less than ideal circumstances. Not only that, he helped save the International WAVA Track and Field Championships in Puerto Rico in September of 1983, before David and I had arrived. David and Al spent several years together on the WAVA board. WAVA is the World Association of Veteran Athletes, which now is called World Masters Athletics. A couple incidents we recall now that endeared us to Al. David and I had been invited by the Masters Track and Field Sports Federation of South Africa to survey the sports facilities for a possible site for Masters Track and Field World Championships. We invited our colleague in Los Angeles, Al Sheahen, to join us. After a very long flight to Johannesburg, South Africa, and before retiring for the night at the hotel in Johannesburg, our hosts insisted on a late, light dinner at the hotel. Poor Al was so tired, he actually fell asleep over his soup and almost hit the plate, incident we never let him forget. On that same trip, we were escorted to Kruger Animal Park in South Africa. Al seemed impressed with everything as we're in the car touring inside the park, but when a large group of giraffes loomed up ahead in the road, he became very excited, almost leaped out of the car, and announced that his trip to the park was quite complete with that incredible sight. What fun to see him so enthusiastic. Yes, we are missing him and greatly feel his loss. All we can see now is the world is a better place for having had him in it, and now rest in peace, dear friend. With affection, David and Linda Payne.
Fighting for a position here. I'm looking at two people who wish to speak, and John Yazzo is going to come up. John will tell you. John and Al have played softball together for many, many years.
A couple of weeks. God, I can't get through any of these small Can't do this to a fat, small Italian. Try to get me through. My God, this is crazy. I forgot what I was going to say, but that's not unusual because I'm 80 years old and I forget where I was 5 minutes ago. Al is quite a guy. I mean, I'm going to tell you something. He was in the hospital, and I didn't know how serious his condition was, but Al called me. I'm sorry, I called Al. Because Bob sent me his number, and I called him and got him in the hospital. And all he wanted to talk about the entire time was how I was. He wanted me to explain all about my torn labrum and the bone spurs on my whatever this thing is. I can't remember. Anyhow, I had a big operation for that. I had an aneurysm, 7-millimeter aneurysm that I had a big operation on. I was like in the hospital on the table for 6.5 hours, 6 days at Cedars-Sinai. Only cost $493,000, but you know, we don't talk about that because I didn't pay it. You people paid. No, they settled for $47,000, I agree. Anyhow, Al wanted to know all about my aneurysm operation. And he wanted to know about my broken back. I fell on one of our games. I was pitching, and the guy hit a ball to my left. And being a jock, you know, you're magic. Immediately, as you do something, I grinned. Reached out, I caught it, fell flat on my back, and I broke my back, C, or whatever that is. They told me it was C12. Anybody know where C12 is? Anyhow, somewhere up here. Al wanted to know all about that. And so the entire time we're on the phone, he wasn't telling me how we were. He didn't sound bad at all. He sounded great. And I told him, I said, Al, you're going to be great, man. You're going to be home very shortly. And everything was fine, and we hung up. You know, and it was a tremendous shock to me when I found out that Al died. Bobby, you said something earlier. You said, if if Al is in heaven. There's no if, Bobby. Al is in heaven. Okay, I don't know why you would say if, unless you, maybe you thought that Al was an atheist, but I'll tell you something. God doesn't care whether you're an atheist, a Mormon, a Muslim, a Jew, an Italian, a Catholic. He doesn't care. You know, he brings all of his people, all of his children home sooner or later, and he doesn't care. And he doesn't pass judgment. And I'm going to tell you something. I'm reading a great book right now that all of you should read. Everybody in this room should read Killing Jesus by Bill O'Reilly. What a great book. It's a history book, and it's fantastic. And it'll remind you of Al, because Al was Jesus walking around on a softball field. Anyhow, I just want to let you know, I got a message from God, and he said that Al is doing fine up there. He's now managing the All-Star team.
Can't get through here again.
our wonderful friend, our next speaker will be our wonderful friend who happens to be a Superior Court judge. She's presiding over the most important trial right now in Southern California, and she has taken the time to come here to our event to honor Al, and we so appreciate it. She brought one of the lawyers from the case as well, but we won't mention him. So, Judge Kathleen Kennedy.
You know, John Yotso is a hard act to follow, and I think Al may be kind of rolling in his grave at the mention of Bill O'Reilly. I don't know. But anyway, Al was a really special friend to me. And I only really got to know him since I started playing senior softball about maybe 5 years ago or so. And, I mean, I could tell from the first time that I met him that he was just really a special, special person. And he was a really special friend to me, and I miss him tremendously. And I know the family does, and all of you do. And I wish I had, like, a really funny story to tell you about Al, but I really don't. You know, he and I were, you know, really good Dodger fans together. And I will tell you that, especially during this whole last Dodger season, that Al and I would exchange emails during every Dodger game. And we would kind of, you know, at the end of every game, analyze what went wrong, what went right. And another thing that I know that would have Al turning in his grave is the fact that Mattingly's contract got extended. Because that was one thing that we, you know, shared an opinion about was, you know, the Dodger manager. But Al was really a caring guy, and his book that he just published was really, really important to him. And this whole guaranteed income, I don't know if you'd call it a movement or exactly how you describe it, was also really, really important to him. And in his last days in the hospital, when I had a chance to spend some time with him, one of the things that he told me was he felt really guilty, that he felt that he hadn't done enough for that particular cause. And I told him that he'd done probably more than anybody for that cause, and that he should just try to enjoy, you know, the life that he had left and not worry about it anymore. But Al always worried about the things that he cared about, and he never stopped. And he also really, really loved his family, especially Bob's children. And he spent a lot of time talking to me about how he felt about them and how proud he was of them. And I just really miss Al, but I know, like all of you, agree that, you know, if there is a heaven, he's there. And thank you for letting me share a few thoughts with you tonight.
In case it's not clear, what Judge Kennedy was talking about on this basic income guarantee is Al's project, as it were, his avocation, promoting a total revision of the welfare system to provide for a different kind of economic redistribution. You'll see it in his book if you have time to read it. You'll see it in the articles which we put together in the booklet, which we encourage you to read. But to follow up on what Judge Kennedy was saying, you'll see some of the letters in there are about the Dodgers. And so while he would write about the poor and about mothers and about welfare reform, he also published letters on the Dodgers, and we couldn't be more proud of him for that. I believe Mike Steinfeld wishes to say something.
I've also been part of this touch football game that's been going on since God had pimples, and the numbers could be great. We could have an 8-on-8 with 8 reserves on either side, and sometimes it would just be me and Robert throwing the ball back and forth. This particular game was one of these low turnouts. It was so bad that I had to be a quarterback. And Al was on my team, Robert was on the other, Robert was covering Al. And I had a great idea. I said, Al, what I want you to do is go out about 5 yards, grab your knee and howl in pain. And as most of you know, Al does not have a deceptive bone in his body. And he said, Al said, but it's beautiful, I can't do that. Beautiful baritone. I said, just do it. Let's just come on. Let's have fun. It's, you know, whatever. Let's just do it. So sure enough, Al goes out about 5 yards, grabs his knee, howls in pain. Younger brother Robert goes rushing over. Al, are you okay? And Al takes off. And the look on Robert's face was like, like the betrayal, you know, he'd never been betrayed like that from his older brother before. I overthrew Al. Because as I said, I'm a terrible quarterback. Nevertheless, Al strode back to the huddle with that gait of his, like the chief running down the court and one flew over the cuckoo's nest, you know. So. He was so proud of himself. Just a quick story.
We have no speakers list. If there are any volunteers, anybody who wishes to say something, raise a hand. Okay. I see a hand. I see two hands. Let's. Okay.
Hi, my name's Anita, and I am. I've taken. Al asked me if I would take over our San Fernando Valley Results Domestic Poverty Group, and that's how I met Al last June. And I've taken over his place. He asked me if I would do it, and I know that I have very big shoes to fill. This is something that we have a monthly conference call, and yesterday our conference call they talked about Al, and I just wanted to read. He was beloved at Results, and a lot of the people that have been on the calls know his voice that we keep speaking of, and a lot of them have said that even though that they didn't know Al personally, they knew his voice, and they certainly know his work. And this is from Results. Results is sad to announce that Al Sheahen, our longtime group leader from the Results San Fernando Valley group, died last week. Al was a longtime champion for social justice and for helping people living in poverty. He was a fierce advocate for the basic income guarantee, BIG, which would ensure that everyone in America would be guaranteed a minimum income so to meet their basic needs. He even wrote a book about it. It was released last year. Al was such a frequent letter writer to the editor and contributor, the Los Angeles Daily News dedicated a page to him last week. We thank Al for his years of service to Results and other important causes and we send our condolences to his family. We will miss you, Al. And our group poverty group leader, we have a call every week, and Al would be on that, and he taught me what I had so little time to learn from him, and I wish that I had had more time to get to know him. This is from Kinley Spaulding, and she was our Results Domestic Poverty group leader. Al was quite the advocate and a tireless worker for equality for all. Having recently written and promoted his book on the subject, he will be missed by all of those who knew him and the hundreds of thousands that he advocated for. Bless you, Al. Thank you.
This is kind of a follow-on to Mike Steinfeld's thing. Yes, there were times when there weren't very many people there at a touch football game. And I want to tell you how these things got started in the first place. Once upon a time in a city called Cleveland Heights, around 1950, there were these football games that always took place on Thanksgiving Day, and they were called the Mud Bowl. And there were two teams. The one team was Al and Bobby. And the other team was Tommy, equals me, and my local friend Dave Leonard. Okay. Well, the numbers are such that Al was fully grown at about 6'3". Bobby was about 4 feet high. Okay. And Tommy and Dave were about five, maybe a little over 5 feet high. So, in order to conduct his team, Al would pass to himself, essentially, by throwing the ball way up in the air and then running down the field and trying to catch it. And being taller than everybody else on the field, he could do that. But fundamentally, this started about 1950, and by 1955, when Al moved to California, Bob had grown to enough of a height that he was functional as a teammate. So I don't remember which years Dave and Tommy won, but there were times also when Al and Bobby won. But that's how these two guys got started in the world of touch football. And once Robert moved to California in the 70s, then they really got in earnest. And all of you who have enjoyed playing the touch football games on Saturdays for, I don't know, 20, 30 years or so, you can trace the lineage of that way, way back to around 1950 when this little short guy, who's a little taller now, had to stand there and try to be a helper to his big brother Al in conducting a two-person football game.
The next person we are going to hear from is our longtime softball teammate who has been with the Indians for many, many years, a loyal, devoted friend, a great attorney, Barry Freeman.
It's rather funny that I entered the softball league, that'd be 15 years ago, and I didn't know Bob at all. I met Al. Parallel lives kind of following each other. My mother's family is from Youngstown.
The way it is. I will miss Al. I am a very caring, powerful guy in his quietness and his approach. A blessing to us all and a loss to us all.
Hi, my name is Tommy Loparelli, senior softball for I think the last 3 years, six seasons I think it was. And the thing you noticed about senior softball was the Indians, which I think was founded by the Sheahens, the team, it's really like a family. I've never played, I'm kind of an Indian wannabe. I've never been on the team, But I've always cheered for them when they've gotten to the championships. And it's amazing how they have the same characters almost every year. It's like, I don't know how it works out because we have a draft every year. But it's a really great, you know, it's like one little, two little, three little Indians. Wait a minute. Almost every one on the team already. Gary is short. There's Sherwin over here in the outfielder, second. There's David in center. And Gary's pitching. And Gary Marshall. And it's a really, really family-oriented team. And what I mean by that is they meet, I believe, almost after every game at the Denny's at Sepulveda and Burbank there. And one time, I guess it was after a championship, they invited me over or something, and I went over there and I said, wow, this is like a whole new concept. You know, these guys play together, they eat together, they party together. And it was a good, warm feeling. They welcomed me and everything. I kind of felt like, you know, almost part of the team. And Al was, you know, Bob gave a tribute, I think, or on one of the championships about how great they named the team because he grew up, you know, with the Indians when he was little. Anyway, it was just a thrill. I think the last time they won it last season, I didn't play on the team, but I got to warm up Gary Marshall on Al Sheehan's team, the pitcher, in between the innings, and it was. It was a thrill, you know, watching them play together and kind of being almost a part of it. So I just want to, tribute to the Indians, tribute to senior softball, a wonderful Irish-American family. And we're all going to miss them, but as you can see from everything here tonight, what a great, you know, celebration of life.
The hour is getting late. The bar is still open. If there are any desserts left, help yourself to them, please. The only thing I would add, I always like to paraphrase Julius Caesar. And forgive me for the paraphrase if you're a purist. But I just want to say of my brother, he was the noblest Sheehan of them all. His life was gentle, and the elements so mixed in him that nature might stand up and say to all the world, this was a man. Thank you kindly for coming.
Yeah.